Welcome to Otley Maker Space's laser cutter. This video isn't a substitute for an induction by a Makerspace member who knows the laser cutter, but it will give you a head start. And if you've used another laser cutter in the past, or it's been a while since you last used this one, it might be enough to get you going. After a short introduction, I'll be covering file types, Lasercut 5.3, turning on the laser cutter, cutting and engraving, making use of the test files, and what to do when you've finished your session. It's quite a long video, about half an hour in all, but you can jump to the sections you want using these timings. Our laser cutter is an HPC LS3060 with a 600 by 300mm bed and a 60 watt carbon dioxide laser tube. It'll cut and engrave wood, plywood, acrylic sheet, cork, leather, paper, card, and a variety of other materials. And it will also engrave stone, slate, and glass. There are certain materials that must never be used in it though, including PVC, vinyl, and polycarbonate, and others that can only be used in very limited situations, such as metals. If in doubt, ask. You could do real damage to the laser optics, or even poison yourself by releasing toxic fumes if you use the wrong material. There's usually a stack of suitable sheet materials from Kitronic under the laptop, which you can buy at cost. The current prices are posted on the wall. The laser cutter works by moving the laser head in the XY plane. As the focused laser beam travels over the workpiece, it either cuts through it or, depending on the power settings and the speed of travel, merely etches or marks it. Most of the time, we want the laser to follow lines, straight or curved, to cut out a shape or draw an etched picture, as a pencil would on a sheet of paper. This is called vector mode, and the vector files that this laser cutter uses are DXF and the less common PLT. I'm afraid SVG files, another common vector format, are no good. Various paid-for graphics packages such as CorelDRAW and Adobe Illustrator will produce DXF files, and so will Inkscape, a free one. It's also possible to download a DXF file from a design created in some CAD packages, such as Fusion 360, but not Tinkercad. The alternative way to use the laser cutter for etching, but not cutting, is in raster mode. The laser head then scans across the workpiece line by line, like a dot matrix printer, building up an image pixel by pixel. Image files such as JPEGs and bitmaps can be used in raster mode to etch something detailed like a photograph onto wood or stone. But it may take some experimentation to get the settings just right to produce a clear image. Before you save your file, it's a good idea to draw a rectangle of known size around the design. Then when you open it in the laser's software package, Lasercut, it's very easy to check that it's come across at the right size. Sometimes it doesn't. Save the file you want to cut or engrave onto a USB memory stick and bring it down to the makerspace. There's a dedicated laptop connected to the laser cutter, running Windows 7. Turn it on with the button at the back left of the keyboard. You can navigate around the screen using the trackpad and the left and right mouse buttons beneath it. When the laptop boots up, put in the password, just ask someone if you don't know what it is. Then plug your USB stick into any of the four ports in this hub. Don't be tempted to remove or fiddle with the pale grey USB dongle that's already plugged into the laptop. Lasercut won't work without it. If a dialog box pops up asking what you want to do with the external memory drive you've inserted, just close it down for now. By this point, strictly speaking, you ought to have started the clock on your laser session by entering the time on your log sheet in the folder. In any case, if you know what you're doing, you'll be turning the laser cutter on now too, because by the time it's warmed up for 5 minutes, you'll be ready to go. And you definitely need to start the clock when you turn the laser on. But if you're just finding your way around the Lasercut software package and trying to understand how to use the laser cutter, then hold off for now. Once the Windows desktop appears, double-click on the laser cut icon, which is highlighted with a red ring here. Lasercut 5.3 is a software package that tells the laser cutter what to do by creating a cut file from a vector graphic or from an image file that you want to raster engrave. When Lasercut opens up, you see this screen. It's set to suit our laser cutter, with the big rectangle representing the 600 by 300mm bed. You'll notice that there are drop-down menus along the top of the screen and various icons on the left-hand side that give access to other commands. The first thing to do is to import the file that you've brought by clicking File at the top left, then Import. You'll need to navigate to the correct drive, the removable E drive, which is your USB stick. Then highlight the relevant file with the cursor. If you don't see a preview of a DXF file at that point, then it probably isn't going to import. This sometimes happens with files that are saved in a more recent version of DXF than Lasercut can cope with. DXF version R14 probably has the best chance of success, so save in that format if the design software you're using has a choice. As an alternative to importing a file from your USB memory stick, you may want to open one of the test files stored on the laptop in Lasercut's own format, which has the file extension .ecp. You'll find them in the C drive with the path Users, Makerspace, My Documents, Test Files. More on them later, but you can see here that there's one for each power level as a percentage of 60 watts in 5% or 10% increments starting at 10%. And there's also a kerf test and an engraving test. But going back to where we were, importing a vector or raster file that you've brought, select the file, then click Open. It should appear coloured red with a blue cross in the middle to show it's selected, like this. Before doing anything else, hit Ctrl Y. This places the design in the centre of the rectangle that represents the bed. If you've imported a file but you can't see anything, the chances are it's because, for some reason, it's not within the rectangle that denotes the bed, and Ctrl Y will resolve that. Also, sometimes the units go awry when importing, so if you still can't see it, it might be because it's very big or very small, in which case try zooming right in and out using these zoom controls. To check the size is right, the whole design needs to be selected. You may have clicked somewhere on the screen by now, in which case it could have changed from red to black, showing that it's no longer selected, and you'll need to select the pick tool first. It's this one at the top with the little arrow, and drag it across the design to select. Once it's all red, use this resize tool on the left-hand side of the screen. The dimensions that come up in the box will be the size of the bounding rectangle you drew. You can edit them if they're not right, and everything within the bounding rectangle will change in proportion. If you change one dimension and then click the three dots to the right of the box for the other one, it'll change to keep the same aspect ratio as before. Then, when you've finished with the bounding box, you can click outside it to deselect everything, then just click on the box itself and, while it's still selected, hit the delete key on the laptop keyboard to get rid of it. Reselect what's left of the design again by clicking and dragging a selection box over it with the pick tool. You can then drag the blue cross in the middle of the selection to move the whole thing around the screen if you wish. There's usually no need to move it away from the centre because you can place the workpiece in the centre too and line it up, as we'll see later. To add to a selection when you have the pick tool activated, hold Ctrl down while clicking additional lines. With the design or any part of it selected, as well as moving and scaling, you can rotate with the Rotal tool, flip from side to side or top to bottom, and do various other things too. Have a play with the tools on the left-hand side. If you hover the mouse over an icon, its name will appear. You can draw simple shapes like circles and rectangles, as well as tweaking the shapes that are already there. You can always use the undo command or if all else fails, re-import the file from the USB if something goes wrong. One tool that it's almost always worthwhile using with vector files is Unite Lines, which you'll find here under Tools. Often, when a DXF is opened in Lasercut, the lines don't quite connect up, so a square may come across as four separate lines, for example. That slows down the cutting time and can cause all sorts of problems. Looking at this design, you can see that there are lots of little yellow squares on the lines, each of which is the start or end of a cut, and the red arrows show the cutting direction. Focusing on the inner loop, there are four little yellow squares, and between each pair there is not one but two arrows going in opposite directions, indicating that each of the four parts of that loop will be cut twice. Not only is that wasteful of laser time, but the double cuts are likely to result in scorching of the material, and the multiple starts and stops aren't conducive to neat, even cutting either. But if I select the whole design with the pick tool and then click Unite Lines, up pops the dialog box asking what tolerance I want. In other words, how close do two line ends need to be before they're joined together? Leaving it at 0.05mm should be fine. This is what I got when I did that with this design. Each closed shape now has only one little square denoting a start and a coincident stop. Note that you can't see the little squares on the tiny circles at this scale, but if I were to zoom in, they'd be there. While we're in the Tools menu, let's look at a couple of others that might be useful for vector files. If you have a DXF file that doesn't seem to be behaving, data check will sometimes do the trick. And if curved lines in your design need smoothing, there's a tool for that too. Once you've got a vector design without unnecessary breaks in the cutting lines or duplicate lines, the next thing is to set the cutting and engraving sequence and the speed and power of each cut or engraved line. You should engrave before cutting and then cut from the inside outwards, and small shapes before large ones. Small shapes could fall through the slats on the bed of the laser cutter or tilt if they're not well supported, and then get hit by the laser head, so you want to get them out of the way first. Set the order in which each part of the design, called a layer, will be cut or engraved. Do that by selecting the layers in turn with the pick tool, either one or multiple vector lines, choosing a colour from the bottom of the screen for that layer. Remember that you can click and drag with the pick tool or use the control key with it to make multiple selections. The whole design starts off black, and you can leave a layer black if you wish, but it's best to avoid using red as one of the layer colours because that's the colour that selected lines go, and then you can't easily see whether that part of the design is selected or not. As you choose a colour, a new layer will appear in the box at the top right of the screen. In this example, I want to cut the tiny circles first because they will then drop out of the way without interfering with any later cuts. So I made them all one layer, which is coloured black. Then I want to cut away the middle section, which I've coloured blue. Finally, I'll cut the outline of the shape from the sheet material, and that layer is coloured green. Having set the different layers, we need to tell Lasercut how each one should be cut or engraved. Click on the little downward arrow to set the mode to engrave, which means raster mode for photographs and similar, or cut, which means vector mode, and is used for both cutting and engraving vector files. There are two other modes, but they're rather specialised and you'll probably never need them. Here I'm setting the black layer to cut. Immediately, a speed and power that are better suited to cutting appear against that layer. But to set that layer more precisely, double-click on the coloured box in the layer column and up comes this Set Cut Options box. The sheet on the wall here will give you an idea of the settings to use for cutting and engraving different materials, but if you want to be sure, use the test files. I'll tell you how when we come to using the laser itself. As well as the speed and power, set other cut options in the pop-up box. corner power, overlap and blowing. For very thin materials, you can drop the corner power a touch to prevent overheating, maybe 1 percentage point. Overlap is the amount of overlap in millimetres at the end of a closed outline. Try 0.1 millimetres or less. Or set it to a small negative value like it is here to create a little breakoff tab. That's another way of solving the tilting problem when cutting small shapes that don't straddle across at least two of the knife blades that make up the bed. Always blow should be ticked to blow cooling air over the laser head. You get a slightly different pop-up box if you select a layers mode as engrave. Remember, in this mode, the laser will raster back and forth to build up the image in lines, like an old-fashioned television, and it should only be used for pictures, not vectors. For raster engraving, there's no need to set different colours. Just leave the design in black and set it to engrave with a suitable power and speed by double-clicking on the layer colour. You can also choose whether to have the laser fire when the head is moving only in one direction or in both directions. One direction gives a better image, but it takes quite a bit longer than if the head can whiz at top speed in one direction. Again, make sure blow is ticked. The scan gap is the distance between each successive part of the laser head, and you'll need to read a few online tutorials and do some experimentation to get the best combination of settings for this, and the resolution of the image you're trying to engrave on any given material. Going back to the box showing the different layers at the top right of the screen, scroll to the right with the scroll bar and make sure there's a tick in the output box for each layer or it won't be cut. There's also a times box for which the default value is 1. It's the number of times that layer is to be cut. When you've set all your colours, you can move layers up or down if necessary by highlighting them one at a time and moving them with these buttons. The cutting sequence is top to bottom. At this point, you can, if you wish, get an estimate of the cutting time. Just click on the clock symbol in the top menu in Lasercut. If you want to change the file you're working on, select File and then New from the top menu. Then you can import a different file from your memory stick or create a simple design from scratch in Lasercut. There's something else that you should check before downloading a file. That's where the laser's origin is set. You can find the setting here in the laser menu at the top. It determines where your design will be placed on the workpiece in relation to the starting position of the laser head. In other words, will you be positioning the head at the top right corner of your design, the bottom left corner, in the middle, and so on? As the laser cutter's datum is at the top right of the bed, it's natural to think of everything as starting at the top right corner, and therefore usually best to leave the laser origin set to right top. Lasercut remembers the setting even when it's being closed down, so check it's where you want it every session. Leave the relative to tick box empty unless you want the laser origin to be set relative to all or part of your design that you've selected. The laser cutter needs to be turned on before you can download a file to it from Lasercut, obviously. Before turning it on, check that there's cooling water in the tank underneath at a level somewhere near the top, and that the temperature on this gauge is at least a few degrees below 25°C because it will heat up in use. Also, open the lid and check that there are no substantial debris in the bed. Vacuum it out if needed. Finally, look at the hose from the fan where it's attached to the window vent with the Jubilee clip. It has been known to fall off. Having done those checks, turn the laser cutter on with the key switch on the side, and be sure to enter the time on your log sheet if you haven't already. There are instructions for how to do so in the front of the file. You should make a mental note of the time anyway, because the laser needs 5 minutes to warm up before you use it. Within a few seconds, the display screen on the laser cutter should look like this. Check that the fan is running. You can put a hand on the red case to feel for vibration if you can't hear it. And put the back of a finger under the laser head to check that you can feel airflow from the nozzle. There's no reason to worry about having the laser cutter turned on with the lid open, by the way. It's interlocked and the laser can't fire until it's closed. Now, with the laser cutter turned on, you can send the cutting file to it from Lasercut. First, in the dialog box on the right-hand side of the laptop screen, check that Immediate is ticked. If it isn't, the laser cutter will position the design on the laser bed where it's shown on the virtual bed in Lasercut. You may want that in some situations, but usually it's better to manually position the laser head where you want the top right corner of the design to be, as we'll see in a minute. Now click on Download and a dialog box will pop up. To send the cutting file to the laser, click Download Current, or click Download File if you want to save it to a memory stick first. Lasercut files, remember they're star.ecp, saved like this can be opened directly in Lasercut and will already have all the differently coloured layers in them with their cutting instructions. You'll see a message saying that the file is compiling and downloading. When it's finished, the screen will look like this again. A complicated design can take a few minutes to download, so it's worth starting it before you put the material onto the bed. Lay your plywood or whatever on the slats. Assuming it's smaller than the bed, you can put it wherever you like. But if you're going to raster engrave, don't place it where the image will be right against the left or right side of the bed, because the head will overshoot a little as it whizzes back and forth, and it may hit a limit stop and cause a problem. If the material is too thin to lie perfectly flat under its own weight, tape it down onto the bed slats around the edges with masking tape. Press Datum on the laser cutter control panel to send the head to the top right corner of the bed, its zero position. Then move it to the top right corner of where you want the design to be placed by first pressing Escape and then using the four arrow buttons to move in the X and Y directions. Now, focus the laser beam with one of these focusing sticks. If there isn't one on the laser cutter itself, there'll be a few in this little box, which should be nearby. Put it here, where indicated, with the little hook resting on the top surface. Then move the bed up and down, head stays fixed, by pressing the Z button in the middle of the four-way keypad and the up and down arrows, until the bottom edge of the focus tool just touches the surface of your sheet material. Press Z again to finish, and the message in the display showing the Z axis is activated will disappear. If you need to tweak X or Y a bit more, press Escape first, then the arrow keys again. Close the lid when you're happy with the position. By now, the file should have downloaded to the laser cutter. It stores in its internal memory whatever was the last file downloaded from Lasercut until either it's turned off at the key switch or a new file is downloaded. In other words, to cut the same file repeatedly in one session, you don't need to keep downloading it. You've positioned the workpiece where you think it needs to be, but now you should check that it's right by watching while the laser head draws a bounding box around the design with a red light. On the laser control panel, press Test and then watch closely. The laser head moves fairly fast. If the red light goes off the edge of the material at any point, you can adjust the top right start position using Escape and the arrow button controls, or just move the piece of material if that's easier, and try test again as often as necessary. When you're ready, and as long as 5 minutes has passed since you turned the laser cutter on, press the Start / Pause button. Keep a close eye on the job while the laser's running to make sure you don't set anything on fire by having set too high a power or too low a speed. You must never leave the laser unattended, even for a moment when it's in use. If you need to answer the door or make a cup of tea or anything else, just press the Start Pause button and then press it again to restart. In an emergency, flames or lots of smoke, just hit the big red emergency stop button on the top of the machine. If you want to abort the job for any other reason, press stop on the keypad. When cutting small shapes that tilt and then risk getting hit by the laser head as it whizzes between other cuts, press start pause when you spot a tilter, lift the lid, remove the shape in question, then close it up and restart. If you're using the laser for a while, keep an eye on the temperature too. It mustn't be allowed to go over 25 degrees or the tube could be damaged. For any given depth of cut or darkness of engraving, there'll be a number of possible speed and power combinations. Higher power will be quicker, you can run at a faster speed, but it shortens the life of the laser tube, and higher power means a bigger kerf and probably a more tapered cut on thicker materials, so there's a trade-off. Use the test files if you want to be sure you'll get the best result. Each test file is for a particular laser power, and it has a number of small squares that are cut at different speeds, from fastest to slowest. Say you want to find out what setting to use to cut a particular type and thickness of plywood. Start with the lowest power file that you think might be suitable, say 10% for plywood, and position the test piece so that the squares will be between two of the bed slats. Start the laser, keeping your finger over the stop button. Watch closely, and if a square drops down, indicating that is the speed just slow enough to cut through the material, hit the stop button. If you let the laser continue, the beam will hit the bed below on the next square and mark it, or even set the plywood on fire if you let it go on to slower and slower speeds. If none of the squares drop out at that power level, then you need to try again with a file for a higher power level. This will give you the lowest power, slowest speed option. Move up a power level or even two if you want to find out what speed will just cut through at a higher power. That's sensible if you have a big job to do and don't want it to take all day. But bear in mind the effect on the kerf, taper and tube life. I suggest you write the power level on each test piece as you take it out of the laser cutter before you forget. When you've done a few tests, you can compare them against each other to see which is the best in terms of level of scorching and so on. If you're planning to engrave lines rather than cut them, it's just a case of deciding which settings give you a square with the degree of etching or coloration that you want, rather than looking for a drop through. When the job is finished, just remove the workpiece. As I said before, the laser cutter holds the last file sent to it until either it's switched off or a new file is sent from Lasercut. So if you want to cut another one just the same, put in a new workpiece or move the head to a new starting point on the existing piece and press start again. Checking the focus first is worthwhile though, in case the material isn't perfectly flat. When you've completely finished, press datum to return the head to top right, switch off the laser cutter and remove what's left of the material and any bits of masking tape. Then vacuum out the bed to leave it clean for the next person. Before closing Lasercut on the laptop, you might want to save the Lasercut files that were created to your USB stick if you're going to be cutting this design again, to save time the next time around and ensure you get an identical result. Save like this, then close that dialog box and exit Lasercut from the file menu at top left of the screen. Don't forget to eject your USB drive if you remove it before shutting down Windows and turning the laptop off. In case you're a Mac person, you shut down by clicking on the Windows icon at bottom left of the screen and then clicking shut down. Write down the stop time in the log and fill in the other details, including the cost at £6 an hour. Please settle up for cutting time and any materials you've used at the end of each month. Well, that's about it. There are a lot of tips and tricks I haven't had time to go into in this video, so just ask in the laser channel on Slack if you need anything else. And in particular, if you've managed to cover the insides of the laser cutter in sticky residue, and we've all done it, do fess up quickly so someone can clean it before any damage is done to the optics.